Greetings and a warm welcome to all of you in the most blessed name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The theme I have chosen this morning is based on Matthew's Gospel, chapter 22, verses 34 to 46. Jesus Christ is being asked a question. In this chapter 22, the previous passage, we see some of the Sadducees who do not believe in resurrection. They come to Jesus and they were asking question about marriage. They were so worried about marriage life after death. In this world, we all know who are married, how difficult it is to lead a married life, isn't it? To live in common journey is a challenging task. And here, Sadducees are not only worried about the world, but also about after death, what is that is going to happen? And the beautiful answer what Jesus gives is, there is no marriage, give and take relationship in heaven. Sadducees, generally, they don't believe in resurrection, but they are coming and asking about what is going to happen in the resurrection. And furthermore, looking at the answer what Jesus gave, the Pharisees, this is another sect, a group of people, they were so happy that Jesus gave right answer to their opponent group. And that is the reason they were coming and appreciating Jesus. And they were also trying to test the knowledge of Jesus. You know, the questions, there are so many ways in which we ask questions. Sometimes we ask yes or no questions. Sometimes we frame special questions, and sometimes we do have in examinations choice questions, and also there are disjunctive questions, and some are knowingly asked like rhetorical questions, like they know the answer and they expect us to answer the same, and that is how the rhetorical questions are. But these Pharisees were asking a testing question. They were asking like, you know, what is the most important commandment to follow? Because there are 10 commandments which to follow. And among them, what is the most important? And from that, I have chosen the greatest commandment as our theme. The greatest commandment. The greatest commandment, what Jesus Christ gives answer is based on Matthew's Gospel and also in Deuteronomy chapter 6. In verse 5, Jesus is summarizing this law, saying that you need to worship the Lord with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your body. And likewise, love your neighbor as yourself. So he is basically giving two important things, love God and love your neighbor. In all this depend all the law and the prophets. That means the law of Moses and the prophets, whatever they have prophesied and guiding the community of Israel, the kingdoms of Israel, the rulers and the common people of Israel. That all the prophets, whatever they have proclaimed, this is the summary, love God and love your neighbor. And law of Moses also time and again reminded people that, you know, once you were slaves and when you are freed, when you are becoming a nation, you know, you don't be like your cruel rulers who were in Egypt, but you need to be role models, a replica of God's kingdom. That is the reason God has chosen the community of Israel to demonstrate the heavenly values in and through their community life. And also we see that Jesus Christ, again, he asked a question and they don't have an answer. The Pharisees were asked another question in that same passage from verses 34 to 46. Whom do you think about Son of Man? Whom do you think that Christ is? They don't have an answer. If somebody comes and asks us, what is Jesus to you? What is Christ to you? Can we spontaneously answer? Can we really give answers from the scriptures? Here, Jesus Christ is not giving any answer on his own. Again, he is referring to Psalms. In Psalms, we see Jesus from Psalms 110, Jesus Christ is giving response. That he is asking a question like, why David tells like this? And there was no answer for them. Some people, they follow law of Moses. They obey the prophets, but they don't know Messiah. Likewise, we read the scriptures and we are not able to identify real Messiah. Likewise, we are not able to recognize Messiah when he is coming and knocking our hearts. The greatest commandments, there is a twofold responsibility or twofold duties that one believer is expected to do. What is loving the Lord and neighbors? One is a spiritual responsibility, a spiritual role. And the second one is a social responsibility, a social responsibility. These two things are incorporated and summarized in this summary of law of Jesus Christ. Love God and love your neighbors. Let us look into the first aspect, that is spiritual responsibility. Responsibility means it's a bhadyata. It's a goppa bhadyata. Idi devuni koraku manamu favorism cheyadam kadu. It's not a favor to be spiritual. Sometimes, you know, we draw some kind of rules and set of regulations saying that, you know, I am very spiritual. It is not we ourselves should say that I am a spiritual person. Others should be able to see the gifts which are evident in our spiritual life. There are so many ways in which one can adopt spiritual exercises. There are so many spiritual exercises. So this is the responsibility of every believer. Every follower of Jesus Christ is expected to be a spiritual being. Because when we receive Jesus Christ, when we receive baptism, we are filled with the Spirit of God. It is no more that we belong to ourselves, but we belong to God. Through the incorporation into the body of Jesus and through the proclamation of our faith and confessing that Jesus Christ is Lord, we become spiritual beings. And that will enable us to recognize how to love the Lord. If you are not able to love the Lord, that means the Spirit is not within you. If the Spirit of God is within you, you are a spiritual being and you will be able to love the Lord in every situation. Your priority would be God. Your priority would be your Lord. Because there are four things involved. You need to love the Lord with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your body. There are four different schools of thought which is involved in this. We try to, you know, confine to only one or two of them. If we are loving with heart, we are not able to love with your body. We are not able to love with our mind. We are not able to love God with our soul. If our soul is loving, our body is elsewhere. Our mind is elsewhere. Our heart is elsewhere. If you say that, yes, I have given my heart to Jesus, where is your body? Where is your soul? Where is your mind? So many lingering thoughts which goes in our mind, isn't it? When we pray, sometimes we are not able to focus. We are getting deviated from our day-to-day routine in our relationship with God. This is basically an attack from the evil to divert us from the fellowship of our Heavenly Father. And we are sometimes giving or yielding to our relationship with God. Sometimes we are setting aside God. That is the reason Jesus Christ is saying everyone is expected to be bear spiritual responsibility. If you read Deuteronomy 6, it speaks about the spiritual responsibility of a believer. In these chapters, especially in the book of Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 7 and 9, emphasizes about one need to work towards a spiritual family. A believer is expected to be a spiritual personality, and secondly, a spiritual family. This is very important. These commandments should be written on your heart. Ivi mee hrudayamlo meeda rasukovali. You need to write down upon your heart. That means even in the sleep, if somebody comes and asks you, what is your name? You will tell, isn't it? Even in the sleep, if somebody pats you and says, well, when is your date of birth? Then we'll see. Sometimes doctors and nurses make sure when we are hospitalized, whether I'm giving treatment to the right person or not, they'll ask us, what is your first and last name? They can read which is on the sheet, but still they want to make sure from you. And even if you are sleeping, they'll come and ask you, like, you know, what is your date of birth? Confirm me your date of birth. These things we don't say wrong, isn't it? We say accurately, perfectly, anytime. Likewise, when somebody is coming and asking you about God, there should be a spontaneity from your heart. Yes, I am a spiritual being. I belong to God. And therefore, God's word is written upon my heart. In the Hindu mythologies, they say, where is God? Then he opens his heart. One of the gods, he opens his heart and he shows God, his favorite God, saying that I have binded my God, my favorite God in my heart. That is how the intensity should be in our heart. God should be always the dominant personality. And the community of Israel are being instructed. It is not only an individual relationship with God, but your family should have relationship with God. I really appreciate Brother Konai. His vision is not only to confine the newness to himself or to his immediate family, but also to extend to his parents. That is how one's vision should be. That is how one's zeal should grow, that we need to be spiritual families. In verses 7 and 9, Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 7 and 9, here the community of Israel has been instructed, impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your house and on your gates. Here, God is expecting that you need to demonstrate your relationship with God openly. Your family should demonstrate openly. When we go to one particular school, the school vision is impressed upon our life, isn't it? When we go and live in one particular neighborhood and region, we are influenced with that society and community. When we go and work for a company, the company values, core values are impressed upon us. They influence us a lot. Likewise, the spiritual life should be able to impress upon others. Bhakta Singh, one of the founders, founder of Hebron movement, he always emphasized his followers saying that you need to always have the word of God hanged upon your walls. To your compound walls, to your door frames. You need to bind them to your foreheads. I'm so glad whenever I enter into any Hebron influenced families, I admire the ways in which they hang all the Bible verses in their homes. That is the outcome of the vision of Brother Bhakta Singh. Bhakta Singh is influenced with word of God. He was a man of God. And likewise, every believer should be a man of God, a woman of God, a family of God. The community of Israel are being asked to work towards spiritual family. Therefore, the initiation that one need to take is first, you need to write God's word on your heart, and then you need to impress them upon your children. What are our conversations with our family members? Do we talk about God, what God has done to us and to our forefathers? How our forefathers have got transformed with the word of God? Repeatedly, we need to tell our children. By talking and talking, we always bring influence upon our coming generation. It's a greater responsibility upon every parent. You need to impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home. When you walk along the road, you talk about them. When you are lying down, when you are getting up, you talk about word of God. You talk what God has done to you. You do not have to be a philosopher. You do not have to be a biblical theologian. You talk what God has done to you. You speak. What is your experience in the Lord? What is your experience with God? What was the experience of your forefathers? We always boast about how much wealth our grandfathers had. What kind of big bungalow they existed and lived. We always boast about, you know, what we have acquired during our lifetime. We always try to bring pride upon our children, saying that we were able to achieve this much in the community. Glory to God, you can boast about that. The primary responsibility as a believer is you. It is your responsibility to make your family a spiritual family. A spiritual family. And in Psalm Kirtanala Grantham, Modati Adhyayam, Modati Vachanamlo, Dustula Alochana Choppuna Nadavaka, your very mindset should not be like the wicked. Don't yield to the words of the wicked people. They'll try to counsel you in a very beautiful way. But don't go to the wicked people for counseling. Or don't take their advice. Do not walk according to their guidance. You walk according to the guidance of the Holy Spirit. You allow the Spirit of God to work within you. You need to allow God's word to work in and through you. You need to stand away from the sinners. Don't try to please people, knowing that they are very bad. Still, you want to maintain that friendship. If you are a good friend, you will tell them, hey, friend, my dear friend, what you are doing is wrong. If you are hiding for yourself, that means you are a selfish being. If you are unable to tell your friend, when you consider your friend a good friend, you need to tell their weakness and help them to overcome that. Don't go and talk behind. And Psalmist is saying that, you know, one need to be very close to God in order to be closer and closer to God. You should not walk according to the counsel of the wicked and stand away from the sinners and should not sit with the mockers. You be away from these worldly things. These are the worldly things. Whether you like it or not, these things are around us. We are surrounded by these weaknesses, these evil things around us. We need to work towards spirituality. What are the measures that we are taking during this pandemic to grow more spiritually? Because we are restrained from gathering together and worship the Lord as a community. What are the measures are we taking to be a spiritual being? As families, how are we spending time to grow in the spirit of the Lord? Now, no travel time, isn't it? Earlier, we used to spend about half an hour to 1 hour going and 1 hour coming back from our offices. Now, 2 more hours are left to us. How are we spending that? Do we have time to open our Bibles? Do we have time to sit with our family and talk about what God has done in our life? How much time are we giving? Psalmist is saying in words to, you know, one need to delight in the word of God by meditating day and night. Divaratramlu daniyandu anandinchuchu undali. Divaratramlu daniyandu dhyaninchuchu undali. You need to meditate and you need to take a delight in the word of God. Not with burden. When you open anything with burden, immediately the sleep will come. Whenever we say, you know, if we sit for too long to read the Bible, immediately yawning will come. Because it is not out of conviction that we are doing. It is maybe because we have to do it. Sometimes we are forcing ourselves to read the word, praying ourselves. That time itself, we get sleep. But when we are spending time with our friends, we are so enthusiastic. When we are doing our work, which we like, we are so enthusiastic. Do it willfully. That is what St. Paul is urging all the community members of the early church. Whether elders are there or not, whether your family is there or not, whether your master is there or not, do the work willfully. Likewise, when you are working out towards the spirituality of yourself, you need to love your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. This is your role. This is your responsibility. We can work out in many ways how best we can. It differs from individual to individual. I cannot impose my spiritual activities upon others. They can adopt a different methodology. There are so many ways in which that we can work out in our own way. That freedom is given to us in the Word of God. There is no prescribed timing saying that this time only you should pray, then God will listen. This time only you should do like this, then God is going to answer your prayer. Overcome these kind of worldly things. You work out your own ways in which, how best you can be a spiritual personality. How best your family can be a spiritual family. It is not only the individual and the family members to be spiritual, but also you need to work towards the spiritual community. Your community should be a spiritual community. 2 Kings chapter 23. In this particular chapter, we come across about King Josiah. Rendava Rajula Grandam, 23va Adhyayam. 24va Vachanam Nunchi. There he is speaking about, he got rid of the mediums and spiritists, the household gods, the idols, and all other detestable things seen in Judah and Jerusalem, because he obeyed God. He is following the word of God. At the age of 8, he becomes the king of Israel. What does a child know when he is, or when she is 8 years old? They don't even know to eat properly. Sometimes we have to remind them, did you have your breakfast? Did you do your homework? But look at King Josiah. He becomes a king at the age of 8. And then by the time he was 26, he was able to totally commit to God. In Bible, it says, when his reign was in 18th year, he has taken up all these things. That means at the age of 8, he becomes king, and plus add another 18 years to his reign. 18 plus 8 should be around 25 or 26. A young age. In his youth age, he is trying to bring in a spiritual transformation among his community members. We should have that power to bring transformation in the community. There were so many people who were trying to lead people through other mediums. They were trying to approach God through mediums. And there are so many spiritists, like there are so many specialists who are available in the modern time. There are so many specialists, and there were spiritists. Sodagandru, Shakunagandru, Sodagandru. There were so many people who were existing, and he got rid of those people. And he removed all the household gods, because the community of Israel, whenever they are captivated, whenever they are invaded, they got influenced with foreign gods and goddesses. They thought the foreign gods or goddesses are powerful than the living God. And that is where King Josiah, when he reads the scripture, when the prophet tells him, this is what, as God's chosen king, you are supposed to do, is walking according to the word of God. In Leviticus chapter 19, verse 31, Leviya Kandam, 19th Adhyayam, 31st Vachanam. In Leviticus, we see that, you know, what God is instructing the community of Israel. Leviticus 19 and 31. Do not turn to mediums or seek out spiritists, for you will be defiled by them. I am the Lord your God. And in verse 30 says, observe my Sabbath and have reverence for my sanctuary. I am the Lord. Here Josiah, at the age of 26, in his kingdom, he is trying to work towards bring transformation upon among his community members, and that community should be a spiritual community. And therefore, in 2 Kings chapter 23, verse 25, it is written, neither before nor after Josiah was there a king like him who turned to the Lord as he did, with all his heart and with all his soul and with all his strength, in accordance with all the law of Moses. He was following the law of the Lord. As a king, as a young man, he can spend his time elsewhere. But he was doing everything with all his heart and with all his soul and with all his strength. There was no other king before him who was doing like that. Or after him also, the kings failed to keep relationship with the Lord. The kings allowed people to worship their own goddesses and gods. But King Josiah has brought in a reformation, a revival, spiritual revival in the community. He initiates that. He initiated a spiritual revival in the community. When we say that, yes, I love God, there is a responsibility upon you that you should be a spiritual being. Your family should be a spiritual family, and your community should be a spiritual community. Here, Josiah was working towards that. In those times also, there were so many diversions. So many ways evil was haunting the believers. Where there was supposed to be temple, the temple was in ruins. The sanctity of the temple, reverence of the temple is lost. And here Josiah, if you read that entire book, you will know the works of Josiah, what he did. He initiated to bring a transformation, a spiritual transformation, and living according to the word. Living according to the word. Once we live, then everything will follow us. We cannot expect our coming generation, our children, to do that. When we say prayer, when we close our eyes, our children will close our eyes. If we open our eyes, they'll also open our eyes. If we kneel and pray, they will also automatically learn to kneel and pray. If we hold the Bible, they will also hold the Bible. If we hold the horn, they will also hold the phone only. They'll try to imitate us. How are we creating a spiritual formation in our family and in the community? In the community, how are we doing? That is more important. A king, a young man, he initiates that to bring a spiritual transformation. St. Paul, in his letter to Thessalonians also, he writes the same thing. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 1 to 8. It speaks about where Paul was in Corinth city when he was writing this letter to Thessalonica. Earlier, he only planted the church, and about for 3 weeks, he lived with Thessalonian community. And the Jews, who were so much annoyed with the teaching of Paul, they asked him to leave the city. In spite of all that discouragement, all that humiliation, he did not give up working for the edification of the church. When we work in the kingdom of God, there will be discouragement. Paul was insulted, humiliated. He was asked to leave the city. People raised stones against him. But still he did not give up. His passion is to edify the church. In our day-to-day life, how are we edifying our church? If some discouragement comes, we want to go to another church, leave one church to the other, shop around. If our identity is not there, we want to leave the church. If there is no appreciation, then we don't want to go to church. What is the use of going to church? This is what we ask. ఈ చర్చికి వెళ్ళి లాభం ఏంటండి? ఏం లాభం లేదు. లాభం కొరక చర్చికి వెళ్ళేది? ప్రయోజనాల కొరకు వెళ్తున్నావా? పౌలు అంటాడు కదా, దినదినము దేవుని యొక్క సంఘ క్షేమాభివృద్ధి కొరకు ఆ భారం పెరుగుచూ ఉన్నది. He was not given any kind of recognition in the churches, but still he was working with that passion. What kind of passion do we have for our church growth? What kind of passion do we have for the edification of our fellow brothers and sisters in our church? How much time can we invest in the kingdom of God to edify others? How much time do we have? St. Paul goes on in this mission in Thessalonians, 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 2, he was saying, we had previously suffered and been insulted in Philippi, as you know, but with the help of our God, we dared to tell you his gospel in spite of strong opposition. There was a lot of opposition. And he says, we were not trying to please people. We were not trying to please men, but we pleased God, who tests our hearts. When we fear God, we will overcome all these temptations. When we are spiritual being, definitely we work towards a transformation among our believers community. In the social circle also, we need to work towards bringing transformation in the spiritual realms. And also, you know, among our communities, we need to work towards that. Here, St. Paul is trying to do that. And in that same chapter, verse 8, he says, we loved you so much that we were delighted to share with you not only the gospel of God, but our lives as well, because you had become so dear to us. Garavinchunatluga ma pranamulanu meeku ichchutaku siddhapadi untimi. Thalli e vidhanga garabham chestundo aa vidhanga paul antadu mem, we have shown a motherly love to you though you people have insulted us. As an apostle, I had the authority, but still I was playing a servant role in our churches, in our communities, among our believers' communities. What is our role? What are we aspiring? How are we edifying others? How are we giving our lives? He says, we were delighted to share with you not only the gospel, but our lives. Our lives. We need to give life, our life. How much are we really giving? Our time, our talents, our resources. How much are we investing for the edification and the growth of the church? That is very important. When you say, yes, I am loving the Lord, I am fulfilling the commandment, you should be able to do these things. One need to be prepared like King Josiah, Joash, and like St. Paul, to bring a transformation in the community and in the society. The second point, what does it mean to love your neighbor as yourself, is a social responsibility. Jesus is talking about social responsibility. The first thing he was talking about, the spiritual responsibility. Now he speaks about the social responsibility. Love your neighbor as yourself. What does it mean? Your personality should be shaped by the word of God. That means there should be an action. The outcome is that you need to be molded according to the word of God. Your action should depict you. In book of Deuteronomy chapter 22, that speaks about believers or a God's children's social responsibility. Dvithyopadesha kandam 22 adhyayam miru samayam unnapudu chadavandi. Samajam yokka bhadhyata. ఏ విధంగా మనం కలిగి ఉండాలో అక్కడ దేవుని వాక్యంలో స్పష్టంగా చెప్పబడుతుంది. When you say, yes, I love God and love neighbor, you need to fulfill what is written in the word of God. It is related to our attitudes and our actions. in our heart, you know, let these thoughts should come. That is, do not mistreat others. Here, Jesus, God is reminding the community, saying that don't mistreat others. And do not take advantage of the widow or fatherless. That means don't try to dominate on the weaker person or the weaker sex or the marginalized communities. We always want to show our domination on the weaker person. When I was in the school, I was always taught by my seniors saying that don't fight with your juniors. If you have courage, fight with your seniors. If you want to show your courage with your seniors when it comes to fighting. Don't fight with your younger ones because they are weak. Don't fight with the weaker sex. Don't fight with the marginalized. Don't fight with the poor man. Here, the word of God is saying that do not take advantage of those people. మనుషులను వాడుకోకూడదు అని దేవుని వాక్యం చెప్తుంది. అమెరికాలో చాలా మందిని చూస్తాం, మనుషులను ఎలా వాడేయాలనో మనకు బాగా తెలుసు. అవకాశం వస్తే ఎలా వాడేయాలి, బుక్ రాయమంటే అందరం రాయగలుగుతాం, మంచి థీసిస్ రాయొచ్చు. విఆర్ ఆల్ స్పెషలిస్ట్ ఇన్ దట్, హౌ టు యూజ్ అదర్స్, హౌ టు ఎక్స్ప్లాయిట్ అదర్స్. వి కెన్ ఆఫర్ కోర్స్, ఇఫ్ పాసిబుల్ వి నీడ్ టు ఆస్క్ బ్రదర్ రమేష్ at GCU or ASU, we can introduce a course. Everybody will enroll in that also. It will be highly in demand for these kind of courses. How to exploit others. How to take advantage on others. But here the word of God is saying, you need to be distinct because there is a social responsibility when you say that I am loving my neighbor. Do not mistreat others and do not take advantage. Be compassionate because I am compassionate. Be compassionate. How compassionate are we? How much compassion can we show to others? How much compassion that we are demonstrating in and through our actions? This week, one of the pastors passed away in India with corona, and he was in hospital and incurred a huge bill. And here in United States, I am a part of a group saying that CSI family group. There were about 130 people. And the medical bill was about 14 lakhs and the dead body was not given to the family. And they have a young grown up son, but is not doing job anymore now. Son and daughter, wife is not working. The pastor served for 30 years. He doesn't have his own house. He doesn't have anything. The church organization was not able to meet all the bills. So they were appealing people. So that is how that has come to me also. Then I shared in this 130 members group saying that let us all give $50-$50. If it is 130 members into 50, it will be about $5,000 to $6,000. At least from our side, we can give about 2 to 3 lakhs of rupees. No response. No response. And immediately somebody wrote something. Praise God. People only want to do thumbs up, thumbs down, like, yes, praise God, praise God. In reality, they don't want to. Working and living in America, giving $50 is nothing in these days. If two of us go to a restaurant, we pay more than that, isn't it? If two of us go, just go and sit in a restaurant, we spend more than that. But we don't have a heart. That really, really pricked my heart so much this week. Why people are so stubborn? Okay, if they have other commitments, they can mention, yes, I can't give now. No response for such things. We do not want to take up social responsibility. It was not a rich man. It was not a bad man. He was a pastor, a simple pastor who was serving God. He was living in the name of the Lord. When opportunity was given, we didn't do that. That people in Hyderabad or some other regions have come forward and they were able to raise in 3 hours, and they were able to give him proper burial. We could not do anything. Having resources and we are not giving. God has blessed us so much, but in reality, we do not want to put into action. When we say that, yes, I love God, I'm a spiritual person. Where is our relationship with God when you are a failure with your brother? In James, Yaakov Patrika, 2nd Adhyayam, 27th Vachanam antadu. Nijamaina bhakti edanaga. The true religion, he says, the true religion. In Telugu, it says, Nijamaina bhakti edanaga. That our God, our Father, accepts as pure and faultless is this, to look after or visit orphans and widows in their distress, and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world. That means in ESV it says, keep unstained. Don't have stain marks of this world. You remain unstained. This is their true religion, he says. These are the values which were taught to the early church. When we say about book of Deuteronomy, some of us may say, we are not following Old Testament, Pastor. We are following New Testament. Yes, that is the reason. Even in New Testament also, social responsibility is recorded. In James chapter 2. Here also in 1 John, in 1st letter of John chapter 4 verse 19. We love because he loved us. If anyone says, I love God, yet hates his brother, he is a liar. Whoever loves God must also love his brother. Don't hate people. Don't hate people. If somebody comes and tells us about any person, with our looks itself, we insult that person without knowing them, without knowing the truth. By ignoring them, we try to insult them. Here, the word of God is saying that, you know, do not hate your brothers. Do not hate your sisters. Because God has loved us so much. He has forgiven every weakness, whatever we have. Therefore, we need to forgive others. Better don't hate. And further, do not take revenge. In Leviticus chapter 19, verse 18, it says, a young man was coming to Jesus Christ. In Luke's Gospel chapter 10, verse 37, he says, what I should do to inherit the kingdom of God or eternal life? Nitya jeevamunaku varasattuniga undalante nenu em cheyali? We all want to go. We all want to go to eternal home. And here in Luke's Gospel chapter 10 verse 37, Jesus Christ tells a parable about the Good Samaritan, the social responsibility. And finally he was asking them, the young man was saying, the one who had mercy on him, Jesus told him, go and do likewise. Go and do likewise. Be compassionate. There's a social responsibility involved when you claim that you are a believer in Jesus Christ. You have to take up responsibility of helping a needy and suffering person. You are creating a missional culture by doing that. The mission of God is to give. The mission of God is to help. And when you are doing that, you are creating a new culture. Idi yeste pastor garu nikem labam. Idi yestunavu kada nikem labam. Vallani intlo pettukunnaru kada meekem labam mee bandhuvula. Kadandi. Yesu naamamlo chestunnam. We need to do in the name of God. We need to love others, strangers, welcome strangers. We need to witness through our missional culture as how that Samaritan man, he was neglected in the community. A Samaritan man is not allowed to enter into Jewish territories. Samaritans were hated They were marginalized, but still he had a compassionate heart. In our community, we need to always remember this thing. We need to be compassionate because our God is compassionate towards us. Therefore, we should not hate others. We should not take revenge. And we need to always be prepared to help others. This is the incarnation of the new covenant that Jesus Christ has given to us, that we are responsible to worship him daily. We need to disciple others and we need to serve others. Then you will be eligible to inherit eternal life. Then you will be eligible to enter into the eternity. We all want to enter into heaven. We all want to be part of the future glory. We all want to be spiritual, saying that, yes, I'm spiritual. I'm a believer of Jesus Christ. We need to bear in mind, God has called us to love God with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our mind, with all our body. And on the other hand, we need to love others as we love ourselves. When we do this, then we are eligible to be called as true believers of Jesus. May the God bless us and guide us in the days and years to come.